Welcome to the Cisco Netacad Introduction to Networks video series by Jason Johnson. This video is Module 6, Data Link Layer. The data link layer, we will be covering the purpose of the data link layer, topologies, and the data link frame. The purpose of the data link layer. The data link layer is responsible for communications between end device network interface cards. It does allow for upper layer protocols to access the physical media and encapsulates layer 3 packets, IPv4 and IPv6 into layer 2 frames, and it also performs error detection and rejects corrupt frames. And we can see an example here of our NIC cards needing to be connected. They're connected by V4 addresses here, and the layer 2 and layer 3, you have the layer 2 header, which is your destination NIC and your source NIC at the MAC address, and your layer 3 IP packet and your IPv4 IP address. The IEEE 802 LAN and MAN standards are specific to the type of network, whether it's Ethernet, WLAN, WPAN, personal area network. The data link layer consists of two sublayers, the logical link control, or the LLC, and the media access control, MAC. And that's different than the machine address code of the MAC address, just so from a distinction there. The LLC sublayer communicates between the networking software at the upper layers and the device hardware at the lower layers. And the MAC sublayer is responsible for data encapsulation and media access control. And we can see an example of this right here. This is a packet. We've got our network layer protocol, our data link, the LLC sublayer, our 802.2 protocol, LLC sublayers that's governed by the IEEE, which is one of those governing bodies, the MAC sublayer, and then we have our IEEE 802.3, 802.11, or 802.15, depending on which one we're looking at there. Providing access to media, packets exchanged between nodes may experience numerous data link layer and media transitions. So at each hop along the path, each time it stops at a device, whether it's a router or a switch, the router performs four basic layer 2 functions. That one, it accepts a frame from the network medium. It de-encapsulates the frame to expose the encapsulated packet so it can read it and see where it needs, you know, the routing. And then it re-encapsulates the packet into a new frame, and then that new frame gets sent onto the medium to the new network segment. Data link layer protocols are defined by the engineering organizations IEEE, ITU, ISO, and ANSI, and I'm not going to read all of these out. You've seen these before in previous modules, and I have encouraged you to go and check these out. I will put links to these in the description below on the video, Wikipedia links, so you can go check those out and find more information out about them. Topologies. We have two different types of topologies. We've touched briefly on these in previous modules. We have the physical topology and the logical topology. The physical topology shows physical connections and how devices are interconnected. And the logical topology identifies the virtual connections between devices using device interfaces and IP addressing schemes. Here we have an example of the physical topology. It does show the physical connections and how the devices are interconnected. So here we have the internet, and then we have broken off. Sometimes on your charts, you will not have this box showing the LANs. You won't have this back box, which is a good identifier to show you where the LANs are and where your different areas are and your physical breakup. So you just have to kind of look at these without the box sometimes, but this is a good example for what we're learning here. This is showing us the physical servers, the switches, the routers, where they're located, and it's giving us the physical locations. So if we have this chart and we know we need to go get classroom 3, room 2127, we should have a series of laptops in there. We won't actually list out all of them on this chart here. We just list out that we have endpoints in there. And then we would then on a separate list, we would have how many different devices and then more information about them. But that would be more on a, that's more of a list that you would keep for what your assets are. that you're responsible for or that you're tracking. This is the logical topology. It identifies the virtual connections between devices using device interfaces and IP addressing schemes. We can see here that it changes just a little bit, that we still show the servers and the routers and the switches and the end devices, but now we have the actual connections. So we're showing that that's a, you know, gigabit 00. Here we're showing our F01's connections, F02 here. So we know what the connections are on that particular switch. So if we go to that room off of our physical topology and go find that switch, we should be able to find a switch in that room, and we should be able to go to F02 and find out where that connection is made. That should be the connection that's made on that switch. So this, and it's, this gives us the IP addressing, in this case the IPv4 addressing. Now there are three common physical WAN topologies. We have a point-to-point, a hub and spoke, and a mesh. The point-to-point is the simplest and most common WAN topology. It consists of a permanent link between two endpoints. The hub and spoke is similar to a star topology, where there's a central site and it interconnects branch sites through point-to-point links. And then we have the mesh, which provides high availability, but requires every end system to be connected to every other end system. And it's a lot more expensive to do that because you have to have more equipment and more cabling. Or not cabling, but you have to have everything connected together. Now, the physical point-to-point topologies directly connect two nodes. The nodes may not share the media with other hosts. And because of all frames on the media can only travel to or from the two nodes, point-to-point WAN protocols can be very simple. So you have your network and then you have your nodes. And those are just point-to-point WAN topology. Some LAN topologies are end devices on LANs are typically interconnected using a star or extended star topology. Star and extended star topologies are easy to install. They're very scalable and are easy to troubleshoot. So this is a star topology here where you have a switch or a router. Usually you're going to have a switch here because a switch gives you more ports, interfaces, and you're going to have all your end devices on there. This is an extended star topology where you may have two routers connected to each other or two switches connected to each other and then end devices off of those. We also had bus topologies and ring topologies, but they're not in use very often anymore. They're not common anymore. Two terms that you need to know. One is half duplex communication. This only allows one device to send or receive at a time on a shared medium, and it's used on WLANs and legacy bus topologies with Ethernet hubs. So think about half duplex communication. So you have two people trying to talk to each other, but only one can talk at a time. So one person is going to say information. The other person is going to say, yes, I got your information and here's your information back. And they're going to talk, but only one person can talk at a time. That's a half duplex communication. A full duplex communication allows both devices to simultaneously transmit and receive on a shared medium. Ethernet switches operate in full duplex mode. And so full duplex is you can get multiple devices talking or both devices, and it's much better than half duplex, but there are instances where you do have half duplex running. Another term that you need to know is contention-based access. All nodes operating in half duplex competing for use of the medium, and some examples are carrier sense multiple access with collision detection, CSMA/CD. And that's used on legacy bus topology Ethernet. And then you have carrier sense multiple access with collision avoidance, CSMA/CA, and those as used on the wireless LANs. And I will tell you that you need to know the difference between these two. You'll most likely see these on an exam at some point. So you want to make sure that you understand the CSMA, CSMA/CD, and the CSMA/CA. Now, I don't memorize what the carrier sense multiple access detection is. A collision detection. I know the detection versus the avoidance. And what I do is when I see a question with that, I probably couldn't just write that out from memory, but I do know when I see on an exam what the difference between detection is and avoidance is. The other term is controlled access. Deterministic access where each node has its own time on the medium, and it's used on legacy networks such as a token ring or an ARCnet. And you won't see those very often today, but you still need to know the term of controlled access. Now the CSMA CD that's used by legacy Ethernet LANs operates in half duplex mode, and it uses collision detection. And the CSMA CD has collision detection process. Devices transmitting simultaneously will result in a single collision on the shared medium. Devices detect the collision, and devices wait a random period of time and then retransmit the data. CA is used by IEEE 802.11 WLANs. It operates in half duplex mode, where only one device sends and receives at a time. And the collision avoidance process when transmitting devices also include the time duration needed for the transmission, and other devices on the shared medium receive the time duration information and know how long the medium will be unavailable. Data link frame. The frame is data is encapsulated by the data link layer with the header and a trailer to form a frame. And that's one of the words you do need to be familiar with. You're going to see that on an exam, a frame. The data link frame has three parts: a header, data, and the trailer. So the fields of the header and the trailer vary according to the data link layer protocol, and the amount of control information carried within the frame varies according to the access control information and the logical topology. So we'll take a look at a visual here. So we have our header, we have our packet of data, and we have our trailer. And within that, within the header, we have our frame start, we have our addressing, we have the type and our control. You have your data, and then you have your error detection and your frame stop. So your frame start and stop just identifies the beginning and ending of the frame. So it says, hey, here's where I'm starting, here's where I'm ending, when it gets that data. The addressing indicates the source and destination nodes. You know, source, you have to know where it's coming from. You need to know where it's going. The type identifies the encapsulated layer 3 protocol. The control identifies flow control services. The data is your data. And the error detection is used to determine transmission errors, because built in, it'll say, you know, it'll have a number. And if that number isn't accurate on the other end, based upon all of this information, if some of these bits did not come through, the error detection will pick up on that. And the receiving end will be like, wait a minute, I did not get the same information that was sent based on the error detection area here. And it will reject that frame. The layer 2 addresses, they're also referred to as physical addresses. They're contained in the frame header. They're used only for local delivery of a frame on the link. They're not used for routing, and updated by each device that forwards the frame. So if we're going on local, see the layer 2 right here is just your MAC address. That's the destination NIC and source NIC, and it is in within the same local area network or in the same physical address, or referred to as a physical address. It's in the same area. Now, the logical topology and physical media determine the data link protocol used. So Ethernet, 802.11, wireless, point-to-point, high-level data link control, or frame relay. And each protocol performs media access control for specified logical topologies. These you need to be familiar with, but you're not going to be working with these in depth in this course. You will get into those in later courses. This has been Module 6, and some of the things that we've learned in this model: the data link layer of the OSI model, or layer 2, prepares network data for the physical network. The data link layer is responsible for network interface card to network interface card communications. The IEEE 802 LAN MAN data link layer consists of the following two sublayers, LLC and MAC. Those are important. The two types of topologies are LAN and WAN. Three common types of physical WAN topologies are point-to-point, hub and spoke, and mesh. Half duplex communications exchange data in one direction at a time, and full duplex sends and receives data simultaneously. In contention-based multi-access networks, all nodes are operating in half duplex. Examples of contention-based are CSMA-CD for bus and CSMA-CA for WLANs. The data link frame has three basic parts: the header, the data, and the trailer. And frame fields include frame start, stop, indicator flags, addressing, type, control, data, and error detection. And the data link addresses are also known as physical addresses. And last, data link addresses are only used for link local delivery of frames. Okay, so this has been Module 6. I hope this information was helpful for you, and I hope you have a great day.